My name is Eric Morris, and I'm a historian at the U.S. Department of State. I also serve as the chairman of the AHA's Graduate and Early Career Committee, and it is my pleasure to introduce our speakers this afternoon on the topic of bullying. Each of our panelists will be speaking for about 10 to 15 minutes on the topic, and then the balance of the time will be available for your questions. We will proceed in the order that people are listed in the program. Please note that Brad Hunt is a replacement for Robert Townsend, so even though both are listed, only Dr. Hunt will be speaking this afternoon. I'll go ahead and introduce all the speakers now, and then we'll just proceed. Tim Gilfoyle is professor of history at Loyola University Chicago, where he teaches American urban and social history. He received his PhD from Columbia University and is active in public history in the Chicago area, including the Chicago Metro History Education Center and the Chicago History Museum. He has held fellowships from the Guggenheim Foundation, as well as the Smithsonian Institution and the Honorary Library. He is the author of numerous books, including The City of Eros, New York City, Prostitution, and the Commercialization of Sex from 1790 to 1920, A Pickpocket's Tale, The Underworld of 19th Century New York, and The Flash Press, Sporting Men's Weeklies in the 1840s. Brad Hunt holds a joint appointment in social science and history at Roosevelt University here in Chicago. He received his PhD from the University of California at Berkeley, and is the author of Blueprint for Disaster, The Unraveling of Chicago Public Housing, which received the Lewis Mumford Prize from the Society for American City and Regional Planning History. He has received grants from, among other places, the American Historical Association and the National Endowment for the Humanities. He serves as a board member for the National Public Housing Museum. Laurie Matheson is a senior acquisitions editor at the University of Illinois Press, where she is responsible for working class and women's history, music, Appalachian studies, and folklore. With the support of a grant from the Mellon Foundation, she has been working with the University Press of Mississippi and the University of Wisconsin Press on the collaborative publishing initiative, Folklore Studies in a Multicultural World. Books she has acquired from the press have won awards from the Organization of American Historians and the Appalachian Studies Association. In addition to her degree work in English literature, she holds a doctorate in choral music. Tom Sugrue is David Boies Professor of History and Sociology at the University of Pennsylvania. He was educated at Columbia, Cambridge, and Harvard. His books include Not Even Past, Barack Obama and the Burden of Race, Sweet Land of Liberty, The Forgotten Struggle for Civil Rights in the North, and The Origins of the Urban Crisis, which was awarded the Bancroft Prize, among other awards. Sugrue has been a visiting professor at Harvard and New York University, as well as schools in France and Japan. He is a member of the AHA Council and is the president-elect of the Urban History Association. So without further ado, Tim Gilfoyle.
Well, first I'd like to thank Aaron for organizing this panel, and I'd like to thank all of you for coming. I actually think I have something to say. What I'd like to do in hopefully just 10 minutes is speak as a co-editor of an academic series, specifically the Historical Studies in Urban America series at the University of Chicago Press, and explain my experiences of receiving dissertations, revised dissertations, and talking about the kinds of experiences I've had that I think could help those of you that want to try and publish your dissertations. I am not speaking as a mentor or a dissertation advisor, so that my students that are out there ignore what I'm about to say. And I say that because I think there's a fundamental tension in revising your dissertation. On one hand, there is the desire to get the book out, both because you've worked on it for so long as a project, and secondly, many of you will need it for tenure. And on the other side is the benefit of patience, that the longer you work on it, the more you let it percolate, the more you revise, the better final product you will have. And whether you like it or not, or whether you think about it in this way, the first book will define you as a scholar in ways that those of us when we write our first books don't fully appreciate. I remember somebody telling me that I was trying to revise my dissertation into a book, and I said, 20, 30 years from now, no one will remember. But that isn't true. You do get defined by your first book, and so I think it's beneficial to be patient when you go through the revising process. And there's also several dangers to rushing for publication. First, it's more likely to get rejected. And it's very difficult, if not impossible, to recover from a rejected peer review essay or peer review from at any major press. It's just too difficult for the in-house editors to go to the board and try and revive it, no matter how much they may support the proposal or support the idea. Secondly, sometimes people will submit a proposal with a chapter. There's advantages to that, but you also run the difficulty of failing to convey the complexity of the manuscript, and that also can result in negative peer reviews that are sometimes very difficult to try and overcome. And thirdly, when it's rushed to publication, you just submit a proposal, is that the peer reviews make unrealistic demands. And so you can avoid these three potential problems if you spend more time revising, giving the manuscript more attention, and more patience. I would also recommend that it is better, and this is where I'm speaking as a series editor, to ignore the advice of your dissertation committee or your graduate school mentors who are telling you it's a great dissertation, it's a great manuscript, submit it now. Few, if any, dissertations are ready for publication, no matter how good. In part because dissertations, for the most part, are really a first draft of a very long manuscript. And you may think it's ready, your mentors may think it's ready, but more often than not, the manuscript needs revision. And so this is one of the few times that I would recommend that you ignore your mentors and you ignore your dissertation sponsor. Now, why? I think there's several reasons for this. Sometimes the interests of faculty as mentors, as academic historians, differ from what publishers want. The market in publishing has changed dramatically, especially academic publishing has changed dramatically in the last 10 or 15 years. There's far more demand placed on readability, on concision in one's argument. Publishers do no longer like long books. There's an emphasis on classroom assignment. All kinds of questions that simply didn't exist 10 years ago or 20 years ago when I submitted my dissertation for publication. Oftentimes faculty aren't aware of or fully appreciate the changes in the market. Secondly, sometimes the interests of publishers differ among themselves. Some prefer narrative storytelling. Others emphasize theory and theoretical originality. Others, as I said before, are concerned how long being able to stay on the backlist. And these are oftentimes concerns that professors and academics and professional historians are simply unaware of. Another factor to consider is to choose the right press. Ask yourself, who publishes the best books in your field? What books do you admire in your field? So this, of course, means learning a little bit more about your field. If you can't find out who the best editors are, ask those that have published their dissertations, who they work with. Read the acknowledgments in books. They are often very revealing. You but oftentimes, especially if you're attuned with your field, you'll see the same names, the same editors being mentioned in different books. When you talk with the press, talk with the publisher. Ask how much copy editing they do. This is one area of publishing that has been dramatically cut back in the last 20 years because of the cost of publishing. But having a good copy editor is immensely important. And if you get a good copy editor, you're going to end up with a much, much better product in the end. Contact editors. I recommend that you contact them by email. Don't just walk up to them at the convention here and hand them a manuscript. Generally, if you contact them by email, they can respond at their leisure when it's convenient for them, which I think is better than a phone call. An email gives the editor time to think it over, look it over, and give you a more measured response. Developing a proposal. I think there's several rules to follow when it comes to developing a proposal. First is to keep it short. You should try and explain the major thesis or the argument of the book in approximately 5 to 10 pages. It doesn't need to be a chapter, but you need to compress your argument into 5 or 10 pages. If you're engaged in revisions, you should explain what those revisions are. Explain how the manuscript differs from the dissertation, on how it's elaborating certain themes, how it's expanding upon certain topics, how it's addressing questions that were raised perhaps in your dissertation defense or in comments from other readers. And the proposal should also include a table of contents with a summary of each chapter. Many presses will ask you to give a list of potential reviewers. And you should think about what kinds of people, what kinds of scholars, what kinds of individuals in your field you would be interested in having read your manuscript. Ideally, you would want to choose people that know your work or at least are sympathetic to your work, so you'll get an informed, critical, but fair reading of the manuscript. And then there's a few things I would just like to add about the final manuscript. And this is based more on my experience with receiving manuscripts and what works and what doesn't work. The introduction. Keep it short. No more than 20 pages. Engage the reader. Possibly begin with a telling vignette about your project. Do not advertise your research or your erudition. Do not talk about historiography. Forget it. Put it in the notes. No, better yet, footnote it. Footnote your dissertation when you come to your discussion of historiography. Most readers don't want to read about historiography, and most editors don't either. And we're often told that this is part of the introduction of the dissertation. So this is the one part that really should be eliminated from the revised manuscript. Similarly, avoid chapter summaries. Don't give it away. Don't tell the reader what's going to happen. Try and build some drama. If you give chapter summaries, why bother to read the rest of the book if they already know the argument? Chapters, no more than 40 pages. I've seen manuscripts submitted with 80-page chapters. And for a variety of reasons, you want to keep it short, primarily because if the book is going to be assigned to people outside your field, you want it to have a certain measure of readability. And chapters longer than 40 pages are simply not going to work. The prose should be precise and concise, and I'll quote from elements of style. Vigorous writing is concise. A sentence should contain no unnecessary words. A paragraph, no unnecessary sentences. for the same reason that a drawing should have no unnecessary lines, a machine, no unnecessary parts. This requires not that the writer make all the sentences short or avoid all detail and treat subjects only by outline, but that every word tell. I repeat this every semester to all my students, and I read it to myself all the time because I think we all have a tendency to over-elaborate, especially if we become so engaged in our research, so involved in our footnotes. It's hard to give up those words, but there's a great advantage to being short and sweet. And finally, what do you do if the proposal or the manuscript is rejected? First is that to keep in mind that there's more than one press out there. Secondly, you should look at the peer review reports as a learning exercise, that this is criticism that you would have received if the manuscript was published. Now you can address that criticism and avoid getting that kind of criticism when the book does come to press. Thirdly, you should talk with the editor. Ask them to give you specific reasons on why the book is being rejected, to learn more about what the editors may have said, or the peer reviewers may have said to the editor in their conversations with them. And finally, it's important to keep in mind that sometimes it's a question of fit, that presses have certain niches that they want to fill. Sometimes there's books already in their list of publications with which would be competing with your manuscript. So sometimes it's not necessarily a question of the viability or the acceptability of your manuscript, but more a question of certain kinds of market considerations that may have nothing to do with the intellectual work of the book. So I'll let Brad go.
Okay, actually, and before Brad does go, we've easily got about two dozen empty seats up here. So for those of you sitting on the floor, if you'd like to move up, have an actual chair. We have chairs. If you'd like to sit on the floor, I won't stop.
Very good. Thanks very much, Aaron, and thanks to Brad for letting me jump the queue. I, like Tim, am a series co-editor of a series Politics and Culture in Modern America at the University of Pennsylvania Press, which I co-edit with Glenda Gilmore, Michael Kazin, and Margot Canaday. And so I will reiterate some of the points that Tim made regarding your relationship with a publisher and editor. But I actually want to begin by talking about my own experience in turning my dissertation into a book, and to begin with a true confession. My dissertation was not ready for prime time. 21 years ago, I came to the American Historical Association meeting and interviewed for one job. It's the only job I applied for that year, which was the job at the University of Pennsylvania that I now have. Very strange job market experience, although I won't complain about it. At that time, I had one chapter of my dissertation written. I was hired in April, and I had to start teaching in September, and cranked my dissertation out, most of it between April and August. The last two chapters during my first semester of teaching, an experience I do not recommend for anyone. Take my advice on that one. Suffice it to say, by the time I was finished with my first semester of teaching and cranking out this dissertation, FedExing it to the airport, at the airport, FedEx to my dissertation committee 2 days before the beginning of the spring semester so I could have my advisor's signature so I would be certified to teach your graduate course, the last thing I wanted to do was to pick up that dissertation and begin the process of revising it as a book. That led me, inadvertently, to discover a piece of wisdom that Tim offered, which is patience is a good thing. You should let your dissertation, to use a historical term, to season. That is, let it sit around for a while, stew over it, and think about it. The dissertation is really a rough draft, or in the case of my dissertation, a very rough draft. And you have a daunting task ahead of you to turn it into a book. The dissertation has certain purposes. It's a hurdle to overcome in the process of getting a PhD. It's the chance for you to establish yourself in the field, to show off the virtuosity of your archival skills, to show your engagement with major historiographical currents in the field, and perhaps most importantly, for many of you, it's your ticket to your first job, whether it be a traditional academic job or a job as a historian in some other arena. The dissertation is the most important piece of writing to that moment that you will produce, but it's also the piece of writing that will be read by the fewest number of people. Your dissertation committee will read it, maybe. I'm not certain that one of my committee members actually read through my dissertation called, as was my first book, The Origins of the Urban Crisis. A handful of graduate students working in similar topics will seek it out while it's still in typescript dissertation form. Mine was maybe a UMI bestseller in microfilm. I think 20 libraries bought it, which means that maybe 10 people eventually cracked open a microfilm box and actually looked at what was inside over some point of its history. In other words, your dissertation is a beginning, and in many respects, just a small step toward what will be the most important piece of writing you will do in your careers, which is your first monograph, your first book. In thinking about the process of turning your dissertation into a book, I have several pieces of advice. First, think about your audience. It is not your dissertation committee. It is not anymore the people who are going to be hiring you, because you'll have something increasingly more polished to show subsequent hiring committees if you continue to look for different or better opportunities. You'll have later drafts of the book and finally the book itself. You have to think, who is your target audience? And increasingly, publishers are interested in books that reach a wide audience, at least a wide audience for academic books. And you've worked so long on this subject, you don't want your first book to be one of those sad books that you come across on the shelves of your library. Copyright 1996, no stamps in the back of your library. That means you need to think about who your audience is, and to think beyond the 30 or 40 or 50, or maybe if you're lucky, 100 or 200 specialists in your sub-discipline or in the minute field in which you're writing. That leads me to another piece of advice, which reiterated Tim May. Get rid of the lumpy historiographical apparatus that is the part of every dissertation. Many of the historiographical straw men or women that you set up in your dissertation are going to be forgotten within a few years of your dissertation being written and your book coming out. The battle that you pick with some other person in the field might matter to you and a handful of folks, but it's not a battle that, with very few exceptions, is going to turn your book into something that people outside of your tiny little corner of the discipline are going to want to read. You want your book to be read more widely than that. Next, you have to thin out your detail. Or, as one wizened old professor at Harvard who taught writing once said, kill your babies. You will have all sorts of amazing discoveries that you've made in the archives. I mean, stuff that you had that joyous day when you found something that you just can't believe it was there in the archives. And your dissertation probably has 300 or 500 of those wonderful aha moments in the archives. You can't have that much detail in the book for a publisher to want it, for general readers to be interested in it, and for the book to have an impact again beyond folks who care about the topic that you're writing about. Next, if you are an academic historian, if you're teaching in a high school, a college, a community college, or a research university, use the experience of teaching as a way of thinking about how to rewrite your dissertation into a book. This is perhaps fortuitously one of the best things that happened to the origins of urban crisis, which went from its 1992 dissertation form to its 1996 book form. I taught large undergraduate courses and began to think about my book as something I could or couldn't teach to my undergraduates. Some of you have got teaching experience, many of you still have a dissertation stage, haven't done much teaching yet, but you'll find very quickly that the book that you loved as a graduate student, that changed the way you think about the field, simply will not work, even excerpted down to one chapter or a short segment for your undergraduate and sometimes even your graduate student audiences. It's inaccessible, it's verbose, it's laden with all sorts of material that students who are learning the subject for the first time aren't going to be that interested in. I rewrote The Origin of the Urban Crisis thinking about how it could be assigned in an undergraduate lecture course, how it could be assigned to undergraduate seminars, and how it could reach an audience that went even beyond undergraduates, faculty members, graduate students, to a more general audience. I thought broadly about whom I wanted to reach with that book. That leads me to the next aspect of revision, and that is, again, reiterates a point that Tim made. The introduction really, really matters. The introduction I would describe as, if it works, as a seduction. That is, it draws the readers in and makes them want more. You write a successful introduction, readers are going to have their interest piqued. How is he or she going to actually develop the argument made here in the introduction? Don't go through a mechanical list of what each chapter is going to do. We love this as graduate students, of course, because when you're studying for your general exams and you have 200 books to read over the course of two semesters, having an introduction that says, in chapter one, I argue that, in chapter two, I assert that, in chapter three, it's like, whew, yeah, I'm done now, I can gut that book and move on to the next. But it's not a way, ultimately, for you to showcase the originality and the importance of your scholarship to the audiences you want to reach. You want to draw them in and make them want to read more, and get them into the chapters, and get them into the big picture of your argument, get them into the substance of the research that you've done. Next, in the process of turning your dissertation into a book, get help, and don't be afraid to get help. There's a good reason why the acknowledgments of people's books, especially their first books, tend to ramble on and list lots of names. We are, in many respects, a more monastic profession than economics or political science or sociology or medicine or biology or physics, right, where people are collaborating and co-authoring all the time. We sit by ourselves for excruciating weeks and months at a time in the archives or in dusty libraries. We labor hunched over with the glow of our computers in our eyes all by ourselves. But there's nothing heroic about going it alone. You should get friends, colleagues, people you admire in the profession to read little bits of it. You should present your work to wider audiences, especially audiences where you can expect to get some interesting and critical feedback. Incorporate their suggestions and their ideas into the book. Next, choosing a press and an editor really matters. Editors range the gamut from glorified salespeople who will have little or nothing to do with the actual intellectual part of your book, to folks who are true intellectuals who will read the book really closely, will talk about its engagement with other books in the field, and will make big suggestions for you about how to change it. Ideally, you want the latter sort of editor. You want an editor who will really sink his or her teeth into your book and help you turn it into the best book that it can be. I've worked with both kinds of editors, and I can say I think my best work has come when I've had really good editors looking over my shoulder and giving me suggestions and feedback about how to make the book a better book. Copy editors are indispensable. Many of us are terminally sloppy in our writing, even those of us who are good writers, and copy editors save us a huge amount of grief. Get a good one. So I agree with Tim that way as well. As you revise, with the friends, colleagues, significant others, editors. You should also remember a few things as you're writing. And since Kim brought up a great quote from Strunk and White, I will go to two speakers whom Strunk and White, were they still around to throw their barbs, would have nailed. One, and this dates me in terms of when I was first writing my dissertation, one is former Vice President Dan Quayle. Quayle memorably said, "Verbosity sometimes leads to unclear and inarticulate things." Many books and dissertations on their ways to being books are unnecessarily verbose, and unclear and inarticulate things will not guarantee your book enduring, being widely read, and being assigned. The other quote from the same era, the first President Bush, "Mistakes were made. Historians, even good ones, even folks who've been writing for years, use the passive voice. Mistakes were made. Excise it from your writing." I end up going through even pretty polished final versions of books that come to me in my capacity as editor of a book series and circle those offending phrases in the spirit of Strunk and White. Finally, I would say in terms of the publishing process, you should gather information about potential editors and potential presses. Talk to colleagues who are authors at presses that interest you. Get their feedback about their experience with editors. They are likely to be candid with you in a way that can be enormously helpful. Look at books that that particular press publishes. If your book is a real outlier, if it's something that doesn't fit in with their programmatic agenda, your chances of it going through smoothly in the process aren't nearly as good. You also want your book to be in good company, and this will be my last piece of advice. When you publish, look at what other books are in that press's front list and back list. You want your book to be not traveling alone, but in the companionship of other books, because people who are interested in your topic are likely to be looking at those publishers for books that are like it. It's a fun process, despite some of the pitfalls and travails and unexpected bumps and curves in the road. I never knew that my dissertation, as hastily written and as choppy as it was, would become the book that it did. And it's an adventure, it's an exciting process, and it will definitely bring frustration, exhaustion, tears. You will experience the dark night of the soul, as I call it, that moment where you're about halfway through and you say, "This will never be a book." But you'll get through it. At least, I look forward to reading at least some of your books over the course of the rest of my career. Thank you.
Brad?
Thank you. Before I explain some thoughts that I have on turning a dissertation into a book, I want to tell my story, much like Tom's, how I went about this process. And it has a very inauspicious start here in Chicago 11 years ago at the AHA. I was with a friend, and he turned to me and said, so, you know, congratulations, you finished the dissertation. Yeah, whew, gosh, that's great. But what are you going to do with it? And I said, I don't know. And so we were talking, and we got on an elevator, and you should never talk in elevators, because we were crowded, and very crowded here at the AHA. And he said, well, what about the University of Chicago Press? And I said, well, I was thinking about that, but then I heard they're really slow, and before I can finish the sentence, a man turned around in front of me and introduced himself. "Hi, I'm Robert Devins from the University of Chicago Press." And that's how I met my editor. True story. Don't recommend it. And I didn't have the experience, and I'm really glad the AHA is hosting something like this. I don't recall the AHA did something where we talked about how do you turn a dissertation into a book. I didn't have a clue. I really didn't know what I was talking about. I was spouting a rumor I heard from somebody else. But Robert thankfully forgave me, and he gave me a lot of great advice. And so Tom's advice about the relationship with an editor was really pivotal for me. One of the first advice he gave me was to read another book, which is what you're always told to do, and I thought, oh, no. But he said, we at the University of Chicago Press, I think he was selling me one of his books, wrote William Germano, the book called From Dissertation to Book, and that's really well done. It's probably in its like, fifth edition or something. And if you haven't heard of that, I picked that up. It's down there in the you can get the paperback in there at their spot in the book. But to reiterate what both Tom and Tim said, the time does heal a lot. Now that's a luxury in some ways. How much time do you really have to revise a book if you're looking for a job, you've got a job, you're up for tenure, you're up for reappointment, things like that. But by relentlessly editing and reviewing my work, that's what ultimately made it the best book possible. It's within all the constraints that exist in our lives. There's an extensive review process that happens, and Tim hinted at this, and at one point I sent the manuscript off to Robert. I said, fine, I'm going to send it out. He said, who do you think I should send it to? And he said, yeah, this is where Tim said, yeah, I'm going to need to think about the list of people. I didn't think about it at all. I said, oh, here's the people. And went to one person who I'm not supposed to really know who went to. Wasn't going to really like it. And so I had two reports come back, these reader reports. One was positive, make a few changes here, this is good, maybe a little more there, all very much in the positive realm. And the other one savaged it, just ripped it, just said, why don't you cut the first 150 pages? That was recommendation number one. cut the history part. A little too much history here. You know, that's a traumatic experience. And that's when you said it's frustrating. Yeah, that was, wow. Take a deep breath. And I wrote, you're asked to write a response to these readers. Well, what are you going to say? Are you going to fix this thing that they say, or what's your response? And that was the toughest thing I ever wrote, was that seven-page, single-spaced response to say, yes, the reader number two is right on this point. Yes, I'll fix that. Yep, you're right. We should need some more there. Yep, this should be cut. This could be shrunk. I should work some more on that conclusion. It's not very clear in chapter three, whatever. But I'm going to stand by these certain points and not do it dogmatically, like, you know, do it respectfully, professionally, calmly, maturely. And that kind of give and take between an editor and a dissertation and an author is really central to making something a better product. You know, accept criticism, work with it, and figure out what, yes, you're willing to do, and know what I really can't do. I'm not going to go back and go do a ton more research on this just because that's not where I think where that manuscript thing needs to work. Yes, I will go back and do more research on this because that is a hole, and I do need to understand that more. Those are the kind of decisions you've got to thinking about as you're revising this and as you're sending it off and getting feedback. This conversation about writing, I think, is really fascinating. And it is that relentless editing, every paragraph has to have a purpose. And I went through the dissertation after reading it, I kind of set it aside, actually, and did a project, something totally different. Well, not totally different, but an oral history project that, thankfully, Laurie published, and I want to thank Laurie publicly for doing that. And so it's kind of coming back to this dissertation. All right. And there were lots of paragraphs in there that didn't really have a huge purpose, weren't really driving the narrative, weren't really getting me to the conclusion, were things that I found that I thought were interesting or extra detailed, that kind of stuff. Chopping that out was really hard. But what gave some impetus to that was when Robert Devon said, and I didn't pay attention to this during the contract phase either. I finally agreed to do it. And they said, yeah, we're going to go for it. Ah, great, yes. And here's this little contract I signed at Laurie, which was probably mistake too. But it had a word count in there. And I didn't really even kind of figure out that it basically meant chopping a good chunk of stuff. And I was also promised to add some stuff. So I had to cut 20,000 words, add 10,000 words. That's a lot of work. It made it better. It was good advice. So, you know, even at 120,000 words, that's a long book, and I think the advice given to being concise, to being, you know, tight, readable, that really helps. I am a series editor. This is a new appointment this fall as an at the University of Chicago Press in their series in Chicago Architecture and Urbanism. And so last month I read a dissertation. It was really clear and well written. I just said, wow, this is really great. It was very narrow, but it was good. And it really wasn't going to fit our series. It was on railroads, and a little bit about urbanism and railroads, but it was really more about political history of railroads. But I was able to work with the author and say, you know, this is really good, but you can go one of two ways with it. You can expand this smaller thing by going doing a whole bunch more research. I'm not sure you want to do that. You've got a job, you need to get a book to get tenure. That's probably not the way to go. Or you can do, you can go with this press. I recommended a press that had done other work in railroads, and it made a lot of sense. I said, I know the editor. It really would be a good fit. Oh, I hadn't thought of that. Oh, right, yeah. Something that just hadn't crossed his mind on this fit issue. I think it'll be a great book on an important time, but it's a narrow time. And so that's the kind of, it'll get done and it'll be successful, but it won't go through agony, which it might have done otherwise. A couple other points, and then I want to turn it over to Laurie because I really want to hear what she has to say. Maps and images matter. I think too many times I see an image and I'm not sure why it's there. Tell me more about the image. Does the image, is it really evidence towards your narrative? Is it an important way for the reader to visualize this argument, visualize a part of it? Choose images wisely, not just because you want to have 40 images in your book. Maps are important too. How many times have I read, I do a lot of urban history, and I really want to visually understand a space. And yeah, you know, but for a dissertation, you do it in Google Maps, get it done. But think about how you're going to help a reader understand your world, and how a map can often tell an awful lot of story, and not just to put names on places, but to help describe, to be a real tool. Those are things that I think are significant and underthought during the process, and at the end they often really important. But I'm gonna stop there. One more point. I think this is important, and maybe Laurie can touch on this too. Communication with your editor and the integrity of the process. If you communicate clearly and openly with your editor about what you're doing, about what your intentions are, what you want to have happen. If you say, I'm going to send you a proposal in July, send it in July. Don't come around in December and it's, whoops, oh yeah, sorry, I didn't send it to you, I'm still working on it. Those kind of professionalism and integrity of the process, I think, are really important. Editors and series editors invest a lot of time and energy to try to figure out what's going to work and what's not. And I think that respect for internal deadlines. Don't make a deadline you can't meet. So with that, I want to hear what Laurie has to say.
Well, I made a little handout here, but I only made 50 copies, so.
We care.
But I'm happy that more than 50 copies. My excellent colleagues have covered a lot of ground and given a lot of wonderful advice. I want to talk a little bit about, more specifically, about things you can think about as you're revising your dissertation. One is the idea that your dissertation is really your first book. It's your first major piece of work. It circulates. It's available to people. That research, people can look it up. And if you can think about your revision as a second book, completely separate project, it's really not for the faint of heart to take this approach. I talk with a lot of authors who talk about what they're going to take out of their dissertation, what they're going to cut from their dissertation. If you can think about what you want to keep for the book, that's better. So if you have, you know, a body of material, you know that this is really important, this is really important, this is essential, this is integral, this is the shape you want your book to have, that's a really good position to start from. It's also a little bit intimidating, and it's hard to set aside that huge document, more or less. this huge thing you've been working on for years and years and maybe longer. But, you know, be confident in the fact that that document is out there, it circulates, and your book is an opportunity to take your research and do something with it that you couldn't do when you did the dissertation. Because when you did the dissertation, what you were doing was making sense of the evidence that you accumulated. And now you have a chance to begin with all of that evidence in hand and decide what you want to do with it, decide what story you want to tell with it, and what shape you want that story to have. A lot of dissertations are very kind of sectionalized components. It's very important that a book have an overall arc, that you have an argument that goes from the beginning to the end, that, progresses systematically, that connects threads that carry through the whole book, that you construct a backbone that you're going to hang your material on. That's part of what keeps the reader reading. So that's one of the things Tom was talking about. He's right. You want the reader to get to the end of every chapter and go to the next one. Find out what happens. There should be some question that's in the reader's mind, you know, throughout that your book is trying to answer, and you should be pacing is very important. How you uncover your material, how you present it, but you're the puppeteer. I mean, you already know the whole story, and that's really not the case when you're writing a dissertation for the most part. It's a very important. I think one of the central ways a book differs from a dissertation is in your position to your audience, not only the audience you're writing for, but who you are in relation to your audience. So in your book, you're the authority. In the dissertation, you're the defender. You need to show your committee that you've mastered the literature, that you know how to do archival research, you know how to make sense of what you find. The book is a completely different matter in that regard. You have to show your own authority, not only by the way you handle your material, but by the way you handle your narrative. So developing your own voice and really starting to speak with the strength of your narrative authority, that's a really difficult transition. You really need to sort of inhabit a different person, almost. You need to become a scholar, not just a dissertator. So that's something, it's a very internal change as well as a material one. There are lots of smaller things to think about when you're revising, and some of them have been mentioned, my colleagues have mentioned some of them. I'll try to avoid the passive voice. The introduction and conclusion are very important, and again, if you conceive of the book in a more organic way, the way that you handle the opening and closing sections of it will be much clearer. You won't be trying to tap on an introduction onto a document that doesn't really, that isn't an organic extension of it. Again, writing, developing ideas systematically within paragraphs, across chapters, that's all really, really important. And it can help, if you have other people read your work, and especially even consider having people outside of your discipline read it and see if they can make sense of what you're trying to say, if that's helpful. Read it aloud, that's very telling. Prune detail, customize it to really advance your argument. As we've said, every word should count, every example should count. You shouldn't have five examples to make one point, you should have your very best example and use it in the interrogate, show what you mean, use it in the most, make the most of what you have. This is part of the historiography, but avoid naming other scholars in the text, avoid quoting them. Don't quote your secondary sources. Certainly cite them, absolutely. Integrate their, historiography into your argument, but what we want to see is your argument and your presentation of what you're doing that you have to say that's new. Notes are a place often that you can cut back, you can avoid a long list of, for further information on it, see these 17 sources. And also, if you have substantive information in your notes, you should move that to the text. And the main reason, there are two reasons for that. One is, if it's not essential enough to be in the text, it's probably not that essential. Secondly, unlike a dissertation, which can be as long as you can make it, a book really has very, really real limitations, economic limitations, readership limitations, pricing limitations. And you just don't want to waste those words in notes. You want to use them in the text where they're really count. A lot of revised dissertations, a lot of readers' reports focus on contextualizing a topic more broadly. The topic is certainly very, very important in marketing your, convincing publishers that they want to publish your revised dissertation. Almost all dissertations that I've seen need some kind of broadening. And you can do that through secondary literature. It doesn't necessarily need to be new research. A few other things that aren't necessarily working directly on the manuscript, but I want to mention. One is ProQuest. ProQuest has really changed the world of publishing revised dissertations because the text is now freely available. And even if you put a two-year hold on it, it still is going to be available, and libraries will have it in their collections. And they don't want to buy, no library anymore wants to buy the same thing twice. So that's why it's so important that your book really take a shape that is distinctive from the dissertation. It's wonderful if you have new research to offer, if you're talking to a publisher and can say, my dissertation stopped in 1914, but I'm going to extend it to 1945, or it just dealt with Illinois, but I'm going to expand it to cover the Midwest. That's more than some people can do in the process of revising, but it's very, very, it makes the book very, very attractive to publishers. If you do let your book rest, your dissertation rest for a while, be aware that scholarship is being published around you. So you run the risk, first of all, or of being left behind. And I've seen that happen, and it's really heartbreaking. You know, where somebody says, well, I this was my research, and they're cited, but their book never comes out because people have gone beyond them. It's very, very important if you let a year or two go by before you start sending your manuscript to the publishers that you update the sources. You have to keep up to date with the scholarship that's coming out. Because we look, if you finish your dissertation in 2008 and you didn't have any new literature that was published after that, you know, we think you probably didn't do that serious a job of revision. Article publication, you never want to give away the book, so be careful. Most publishers expect that you'll publish a couple of articles, two usually, is the maximum. It's very important that you not publish a boiled down version of your book. So don't publish the, Cliff Notes version of your book, because then why would people read the book? They just read the article. The best thing is if you have some kind of if you have a chapter that doesn't quite fit, never really quite fit in the dissertation, a lot of dissertations have pieces like that, to publish that separately is a good idea. If you publish two articles in different kinds of publications, maybe you have one in the Journal of Polish History and you have one in Immigration History or something like that, then you maybe are reaching a couple of different audiences, and that's good too. Title, don't pick your best title and put it on your dissertation. Because publishers will tell you that they don't want to use that title. No one wants to run the risk that libraries will think it's the same as the dissertation. So just put some long, awkward, scholarly title on the dissertation and pick, use your pithy quote that's perfect for the book. We've talked quite a bit already about preparing your proposal, so I don't think I'll cover that. But let me just talk a little bit about I do want to say one thing about preparing your proposal. When you write your cover letter, proofread it. And make sure that you're addressing the right press. Don't send a query to me and say something about Cornell University Press. I admire Cornell University Press, but I am not Cornell University. So be really careful. Read it three or four times, let it sit for a couple of days, read it again. Again, contacting appropriate publishers, deciding who the appropriate publisher is going to be, that's an important decision. You might think about it the same way that you think about a job interview. You know, if you approach a publisher, you want to know what they publish, what their strengths are, why your book fits with them, what titles they publish that relate to your work, and I mean, you really need to kind of canvas the situation and make sure you know who you're talking to. Present yourself, as a person who's knowledgeable, who's made a specific decision to approach this particular publisher for very carefully considered reasons, and that that helps you build a much more positive interaction with a publisher from the beginning. I want to mention also timeframes. The kinds of tenure comes up so fast. 5 years sounds like a long time, but it's really, really not a long time. Depending on what your tenure committee asks of you in terms of your book, you need to count on a good 12 months in production, if you need a book. Before that, plenty of time for peer review and revision. I would allow at least 2 years for that. So, and then you should also, as we've said, take a good, careful revision of the manuscript before you approach a publisher with it. So, it's not a bad idea to let your dissertation sit for a while, but not a long while, I would say. You need to kind of move things along. I'll just mention briefly permissions and any kind of fees associated with art, at least for our press, and I think for just about everybody, are the author's responsibility, so just be aware of that. And a publisher kind of pretty routinely will ask whether you have subvention funds available from your institution. That's a completely separate question from accepting your manuscript on its scholarly merits. So don't be put off by that. But it really does help keep the price of the book down. Just gives us a little bit more generous. Just a little bit. We can just treat the book in a little more generous way that way.
Thank you, both of our presenters, for their information and for your attention. We have about an hour for questions. A member of AHA staff is going to make more copies of Laurie's handouts, so hopefully we will have those within the hour. If you have a question, please raise your hand, tell us your name and where you're from, and then ask away. Yes, sir.
My name's Rod Bolton, adjunct at Ford International University. I'll be happy to hear from anybody, but I'm going to address my question to Dr. Matheson. My question is about one particular phase of the process, particularly the phase between the contract offer and publication. And basically, although I can get more specific, it boils down to what rookie mistakes do you see first-time authors make during that period between the contract offer and the final publication. And for example, talking about images, pictures, is there typically any wiggle room, where the author wants to have more pictures than there is in the contract, and that be handled by payment by the author? What is the process? Does the acquisition editor hand off to a copy editor, or do you continue to work with the acquisition editor during the process? Basically, the advice I'm getting is sign anything. If they want 99% of the proceeds, take it. Is that, is that the general advice? Just anything you can offer in that regard.
Okay. Wow, well, that's a whole other presentation. One thing I could say is we only issue one piece of paper as a contract, but it actually means two different things at different times. So if the contract is issued in advance of the final approval of the faculty board, which is the last step in the review, the peer review process, it's called an advance contract, which means that publication is contingent on successful completion of the revision and passing by the faculty board. If all that happens before the contract's issued, which sometimes happens, then it's a final contract and it's in full force. again, that's something your tenure committee might want to know, whether it's an advanced contract or a final contract. Just has to do with what state of the peer review process it's gotten to. Pictures, well, the net, you know, it's that you can have more pictures if you have fewer words, basically. So it's pictures at this, in this day and age where everything is electronic, from the publisher's point of view, mainly are just a matter of more pages. So if you have a little bit of, you know, if you have a little bit of leeway because you have a slightly shorter manuscript, you can probably include a few more photos. For most history monographs, we don't include a lot of photos, to be honest. As somebody said, we want to see that there's a case for including them, that they add value to the book, you know, that they're really essential to what you're trying to do. As far as who handles the project at different stages, I'm an acquisitions editor, so I work with authors in the pre-production stages, and then the project is formally handed over to the copy editing department. It's copy edited, copy editor, the author sees the manuscript, reviews the copy editing, and then you'll also see the page proof, prepare the index. Those are the kind of the main stages. I don't know if I answered your question, but it's not that authors are going to do anything wrong in that period. It's a good idea to start permissions early. I mean, one thing that happens is just things take longer than you expect. Permissions is something you can handle earlier sometimes, and that's helpful.
I have a little bit of advice. First, read the contract. I don't think I read my contract. I was so happy to get it that it was just yahoo, now sign away. Secondly, ask other writers about your contract. Ask them to read it. Because if you're like most of us, we've never seen a contract like this before. Fortunately, I have a lawyer for a wife, so I can ask her to read it. And she finds things in it that I never would have thought about asking. We don't know what really a fair royalty is. Most of us don't even know what a royalty is the first time. So how does it differ among authors? What should I ask for in a royalty? Most of us, after we've gone through graduate school, we have no preparation for those kinds of questions. So it's imperative that you ask questions both of the publisher and the editor, but also others in your field, others who have written books. Regarding images and permissions, beware. I didn't read my contract, so when I had to get those images for City of Eros, I was stunned that I had to spend hundreds of dollars, both for permission and for the reproduction of them. And that's common practice, even with commercial presses, university presses. The author pays. I've seen very few instances, if any, of the press actually paying for it. It's also useful to know what kinds of permissions you need for the book. I know of one experience of an author who needed permission from a particular archive to quote from a particular source, and they read the manuscript. The individual in charge of that archive read the manuscript, didn't give permission to quote, and that author had to go through the entire manuscript and pull out all those quotes. So that's an extreme case. It was an unusual situation, but try and remember before you think of what images, what archives you need to get permissions for, for the final product, that you do that before so that you know that you're not going to run into some kind of roadblock like that.
Yes.
Yeah, my name is Katie Batha. I'm from the University of Illinois Chicago. I just got my PhD in August. My question is about oral histories, and kind of along the questions about permission. What do we need to do, both as we're researching and writing our dissertation and as we prepare the manuscript for publication, what do we need to do kind of on the front end in terms of getting permission from people that oral interviews from. Like, I made up some permission sheet that has absolutely zero legal jargon, but it's got a signature on it. I don't know.
A form like that is, for our purposes, perfectly fine. We also have more elaborate forms that we use for archival permissions that specify we want world rights, we want world distribution, we want electronic, we do want electronic rights, that's very important. But for an interview, if they just say, I agree to have my material used in the book, that's perfectly fine. Most publishers have forms on their website or that they can give you, and I forgot to say that you should take a look at not just the publishers that you want to approach right away, but look broadly at publishers' websites, because there's a lot of information about preparing material to submit.
Yes.
Cheryl Lemus, Community School Steward. I work at online. I'm going to mention where I work right now. I have a question regarding academic presses versus commercial presses. As you are thinking about publishing your dissertation, is there one advantage over the other in terms of where you think about publishing your work?
I can speak to that as someone who's published with both academic press, Princeton, and with University of Chicago Press, but also with Random House, and I have a book under contract with Norton now. So there are pros and cons to both. A trade publisher has the ability to market your book and get it to a much wider audience than a university or than most university presses do. A trade publisher also has very different criteria for evaluating whether or not your book is of interest to them. They want a book that will reach the widest possible audience. Many of our dissertations, including our best dissertations, aren't suitable for or really appealing to an audience beyond the walls of the academy. Next, university presses do something that most trade publishers don't do. They give you peer review. And we talked about our experiences coming up with lists of potential reviewers, maybe suggesting to your editor, please don't give my book to so-and-so, because so-and-so and my advisor have been in a feud for the last 30 years, and he won't review my book fairly. University presses send them out to peer reviews, and peer reviews, if well chosen by the press, are absolutely critical for turning your dissertation into a good book. I was choosing between more than one press when I published my first book off of my dissertation, and the deal maker for me with Princeton, which is the press I published my first book with, was that the readers' reports were outstanding. They really sunk their teeth deeply into the manuscript and had very intelligent and helpful suggestions to make. Another press, which will go nameless, which was vying for the book, really wanted it. It's a very prestigious press, a university press. They sent out to people who turned over their readers' reports really quickly. I got three paragraphs from one person saying, he walks on water, he's the second incarnation of our Lord, his book is truly amazing, it'll change the world. It wasn't ready to change the world yet. It wasn't, it needed a lot of work, and I knew that, and I eventually decided that as much as they loved the manuscripts, I didn't need that kind of, I didn't need unconditional love, I need tough love at that point. I ended up going with what the press did, very simply committed to helping me turn it better. A trade publisher won't give you that opportunity by and large. Next, and we have different experiences. I mean, Tim's first book was with a trade publisher, so he can talk about that. Different departments have different ways of evaluating the author's scholarship. Some departments, when you come up for tenure, will ask for copies of the reader's reports from the press that you've published with. Some put valuations on university presses, and some departments even have a sort of a internal or kind of subjective ranking of presses. You should talk to your mentor or to senior colleagues in the department about what their expectations are for you. If your senior colleague says, we want you to be out there and make the biggest splash possible, a trade publisher might be the sensible choice for you. If your department chair says, our colleagues are going to be really suspicious of a book published with Random House, but if you publish with University of Illinois Press, they'll see it as having that's information that you should have available as you make your decision. There's no one size fits all here. It depends a lot on where you are, what your colleagues are like, and what the potential audience for your book is.
I would agree with everything that Tom said there. I would say that the advantage of the trade press is that you're going to reach a wider audience, but that also inevitably involves more work on your part because you're not going to get the peer review. You have to go make your own peer review. You're going to have to seek out colleagues and other people in your field that can give you the kind of criticism you need for the final product. And in writing my second book, I found that's very hard to do because everybody's busy. Nobody wants to read another manuscript, especially if it's too long and overwritten, like my second book was in manuscript form. So that's something to consider. And if you don't get that kind of criticism, you may have a more widely available book, but it may not be as good a book in the end. And secondly, you also need to have a very good editor. Just as at a university press, you need to have an editor that is actually going to read. It's probably even more important than an editor at a university press, because the editor at the trade press is really going to be the primary reader of the manuscripts. He's not sending it out to peer review, and so it's more critical that you have someone who understands the process of writing, understands the project, understands what your goals are in the book. So I think those are issues that you need to consider when you're weighing between trade and university press.
Another question? Yes, in back.
Yeah, Mark Sorters from Rory University. And I have a question about style, mostly. and particularly about how you go about choosing which babies to kill. and so, I mean, on the one hand, we're told to cut, focus on the argument. And yet, on the other hand, we're told to think about broadening the audience and maybe even thinking about your book being assigned to an upper-level undergraduate course. Often it's those stories, you know, the babies that you have to choose and keep or to get rid of, that make the books readable at that level rather than, you know, droning on about the argument. Well, I'm just kind of curious. I mean, the books are all different, of course, but I'm just, you know, curious, maybe some stories to
Well, I don't think there's a specific answer to that question, but in my experience, I found that the first draft, I oftentimes have too many examples in a paragraph because you're so close to your sources and you don't want to give up that footnote. And that's part of what the revision process is to honing it down. Do you need 3 or 4 examples to prove a point in a particular paragraph? Usually one will do. Oftentimes, too many quotes. You should only quote for impact. And you should never quote more than once in a paragraph. Now, there's exceptions to this, but if you have multiple quotes in a paragraph with multiple footnotes, you're probably overwriting. But I think it's little things like that I think can improve the readability. And ultimately, there's no such, as I say this to my students all the time, they probably know what I'm going to say right now. There's no such thing as good writing. There's only good rewriting. And you have to keep doing it. And you have to rewrite time and time again. And this is why I think Tom is wise to recommend putting it aside. Because that forces you to come to the manuscript with fresh eyes. It's not your writing anymore. It's something that you did in the past. And you can write with more objectivity and more critical analysis. So it's easier for you to eliminate those footnotes, get rid of those quotes, dispense with those excess examples.
I would also put an exclamation point on Tim's comments and say that Laurie's point about narrative arc is really important. You want your readers to be propelled forward through the text. And if you start getting to the kind of the bumps of example after example after example are kind of piling on, then you've got an obstacle in some ways to that narrative arc carrying through. And so you can always show off, as long as you're parsimonious about it, the additional research research that went into that assertion that you're making. You only have one good anecdote or narrative or quotation to back up by sticking references into your footnotes. I'm all for the footnotes being as robust as your publisher will let them be, knowing full well that publishers usually go to your footnotes first and say, thin. And I say, print them really, really small, but keep them all there.
Next question. Yes.
I'm wondering if you could talk about some of the different ways you can approach. You have a couple or three publishers in mind, three different fit all for different reasons. How do you sort of negotiate approaching different publishers at the first meeting?
Well, I think it's a good idea to talk to all the publishers that you think are viable homes for your press at the point that you're trying to settle on one. So you can feel free to circulate a proposal to a number of presses. You might want to tweak it if your book deals with two different strands of history and you want your presses that have strengths in one or the other. You might want to tweak your proposal that way, but. That's all a fact-finding mission to try to decide what your first choice of press really is. Because once you have a press, or more than one press, that wants to proceed to peer review, you should become anonymous at that point and give the press a chance, a period. I usually ask for a period of 4 months of exclusivity. So we promise a decision in 4 months, you promise to let us do that exclusively. But I think you should, it never hurts to have a conversation with an editor as long as there's purpose to the conversation and if your project makes sense for the press, why you're talking to them.
Just one short comment. I think this is one aspect of publishing dissertation that's changed dramatically since the 20 years ago, since when I published mine. You used to just submit your manuscript proposal to one press. Submitted to multiple. And now it's routine to submit a proposal to multiple presses. And presses actually expect it. But you should be honest with them and tell the publisher that you're also submitting it elsewhere so that they don't operate under the assumption that they're the exclusive reviewer of the proposal or the manuscript.
I just want to say one more thing. That's true, but I have to say that it does make an impression on me if a person says, I'm submitting this only to the University of Illinois Press. It makes me think that they've really thought about it. So that's just worth keeping in mind.
Okay,
yes. My name is Matt Mettler. I'm a grad student at the University of Iowa. I have a question about the inner workings of press as an organism with the full-time editors versus scholars who are on editorial boards. I'm wondering how the review process works between different types of editors.
There are different models. Having worked with different presses and being an editor of a series, I'll give you an example from how our series works. We have four series editors, and we have a really brilliant editor at the University of Pennsylvania Press, Bob Lockhart, who oversees our series. Bob and each of the four of us scout. We rely on recommendations. We go hear panels and go talk to potential authors. We also get manuscripts or proposals that come our way that we read. Usually in the case of a series with academic editors, at least one of those academic editors will read the manuscript closely. And in our case, we pride ourselves on working pretty closely with our authors, especially the ones that need some guidance in turning their dissertations into books. We had one absolutely brilliant 1,200-page dissertation that we needed to boil down. It was rough. We worked very closely. It was a brilliant book. It won some prizes and made a pretty big impact. But we, as individuals, caring about the topics that are going out under our name as well as under your name, put some energy and investment into reading carefully, giving feedback. We also send out the book to peer reviewers. Sometimes one of the series editors will serve as one of the reviewers.
get the advanced contracts, we get the final product. And then at that point, just as the University of Illinois Press, it's in the hands of the copy editors and the proofreaders and the folks who do the layout and the production. At that point, we sit back and take a deep breath and then go on to recruiting our next author and reading the next of the column manuscripts that shows up on our desk.
Yeah, that's very similar to our experience with the architecture urban centers, in that we function partly as somewhat like an acquisition. We're not an acquisition editor, but we're out there looking. We want what's going to be the next book in the series. And we want to find things that fit, that make sense, that are well done, that have the possibility of going through this very long process of becoming a successful book. So you can not only do your homework on about the Laurie Matheson's of the world, but also the other people in the series to know, you know, so that if you can talk intelligently about them in a cover letter saying, that also shows, you know, you're serious about this. This isn't something you thought lightly about, and that it's worth the investment of time of the series editors and the acquisition editors and the, you know, every institution's a little different. I don't know the org charts. I don't even know the org chart at University of Chicago Press, let alone, you know, what how these things work. Yeah, do your homework on that.
And submit that as part of my proposal, or to have a fully revised manuscript and have that with the proposal, or something in between?
If you know that there's a huge gap in your dissertation, you know, that there's an area that you didn't research and that you suspect any reader is going to notice, fill that, or at least let the editors know that you have a plan to fill that so you don't get a reader's report that states back to you the obvious. So I think you have to make some revisions to avoid getting feedback that's not going to be so useful to you.
I would just add what I said at the beginning, that the more time, the more revision, the more patience you put in on revising the manuscript, the better position you will be putting yourself in when you make the submission finally to the press. I've seen several instances where individuals revised a dissertation slightly, they submitted a proposal and a chapter, was sent out for peer review, and they got two critical peer review reports back, focusing on elements of the manuscript that are in other chapters. So now that author has to prove that the criticisms in the peer review reports are in other parts of the manuscript. He would have been better served if that manuscript, if he had submitted the manuscript, the full manuscript, rather than just a proposal and a sample chapter. Now, this isn't always a hard and fast rule, but I think that's why I recommend patience. And having the revised manuscript in as final form as you possibly can when you finally submit it, when you finally, in fact, approach a press.
I think you're also asking about the timing for approaching the publisher, is that right? I don't think there's anything wrong with approaching a publisher at a relatively early stage of the proposal. Just be aware, as Tim says, that you should be, you should understand that the publisher is going to want the full revision, the full revised manuscript before proceeding to peer review. But I don't think it's a bad idea to, to start making some acquaintances in publishing at an earlier stage.
Engage in what, as a dog owner, I would call kind of the academic tree marking, you know, that that often is all over the place in manuscripts. It distracts from the power of the sum of the argument that you're making over a couple of hundred pages.
And I made that mistake early on in my manuscript, and my editor very calmly said, "No, that's not. No. Do we? No. Okay, thanks." That took time. That wasn't something I was ready to give up 6 months after this.
I would add one exception. I mean, if there is a giant, major interpretation out there that your research has led you to completely undermine, I mean, think about the huge debate about the Brenner thesis, you know, that has played out in many books and journals. Okay, if you're going to overturn the Brenner thesis, you can mark your tree, right? If you're going to tell us that name your favorite historian, you know, completely misread the period and that you're sorry. Yes, I mean, you obviously can pick fights and argue, but often folks end up doing that in a distracting way rather than the way that really compels the book forward and makes it stand the test of time. You don't want your dissertation to be, "Oh, that's so 2012, you know, I'm saying.
Any other questions?
Yes.
What are your thoughts about bibliographic essays as a catharsis for those of us who do want to talk historiography and to help the general reader as far as where to go from where to go?
I have no objections to bibliographic essays, but my editor does. I think that bibliographic essays, we don't see them very much anymore, primarily because the books have gotten shorter, and they're trying to cut back on page count. But I think they are valuable, but I think that's a decision that is affected by market realities more than the desire on the part of historians to have and read bibliographic essays.
I'm Taylor at the University of Rochester. My department has moved to undertaking much of the process you've already described before the dissertation is complete. As a result, I've drafted about 480 pages. It's now down to about 270. Is this a waste of time? Because what it sounds like is my dissertation is going to be no different. Well, I know it's going to be changed by editor. But I've got it down to something more publishable. I've taken so many of the notes out, so many of the expert quotes. Is that something we should be doing within the department? We should let that happen. Let the dissertation be a great big monster.
I'm not sure what to say to that. Talk about my own experience. I actually spent an extra year in graduate school to essentially revise City of Arrows. So the closure of the publication when I defended. And guess what? It needed to be revised. I quickly learned. I remember having conversations with my editors and telling me to take out this, take out that, stop the cataloging of examples. You need to dispense with the summaries at the beginning of each chapter. You need to tell more of a narrative in each chapter and build to a climax at the end. You know, it's part of the seduction process that Tom mentioned earlier. So I'm not sure I have good advice for if you really are getting that kind of editing from your mentors, from your colleagues, from your peers. My sense is that you're probably not, because they're close to you. They're your teachers. They have an investment in you, and they also there's also pressure now to get graduate students out as soon as possible, you know, to stop the 10 years and beyond in graduate school among ABDs. So I admire the department if they can do that, but I'm a little skeptical that it will happen.
I'll offer maybe a slightly different interpretation, which is that size doesn't matter when it comes to your dissertation, and long dissertations are often unnecessarily so. So if you're writing a really well-organized, crisp 280-page dissertation, instead of writing an 800-page shortstop, then you know, it's the quality ultimately of what's in those 290 pages that matters. Many departments, including ours, have a rule about the length of dissertations. It's in our case completely honored in the breach. I think our maximum dissertations is between 300 or 350 pages. Hardly anybody pays attention to that requirement. I mean, a lot may not that much longer, but it's the quality ultimately that matters. You should have a product that you and you're proud of, ready to defend, and your advisors think is ready to defend and realize, as Tim suggested, it's regardless of how polished it is, it will probably still have a significant way to go before it becomes your first.